Hello, Australia. Welcome to another Big Couch. We have got a big show today for episode 681. Talking movies with Paul Elwin. He's got the brand new movies that are coming out. Ranger Red is in from Red Zoo, and he's got a fantastic friend with him today. Later on, talking entertainment with Alexander Sacosta. Julie Seymour is in from RAC Arena. We're talking about some amazing events that are coming up there. Bitchin' with Ted, Jen and Chris will give you a chance of winning some movie tickets thanks to Palace Cinema. And music-wise, we've got Isabel Green performing on the show. Hope you can stick around. Episode 681 starts now.
It's showtime on the couch. Hey, it's showtime on the couch. You can see it from your house. You can see it from your house. It's showtime on the couch with Fred and the best in town. You can see it from your house. Yeah, it's showtime on the couch. Oh, oh.
Australia, hello Victoria, hello New South Wales, hello Queensland, Tasmania, South Australia, Northern Territory, Alice Springs, I think I've covered, and Western Australia, of course. Made in Perth for the whole of Australia, this is The Couch. Hope you can stick around for the next hour. We have got lots on the show today. Let me go straight to Paul Elwin. Welcome back,
yes,
Paul.
Yes, Fred, welcome, thanks.
Nice to have you here. We've got four brand new movies today.
Yes, hopefully four brand spanking new movies coming out very soon.
Yes.
Yes, so the first one we got is called Baby Done. Now, the way the title's done is like a checklist, you know, like a bucket list. Yep. So what it is, this is a New Zealand production. Mm-hmm. It's a rom-com of sorts, but more of a comedy kind of thing. Directed by Curtis Vanell, who did a really cool film back in 2013 called Eagle vs. Shark, which I like. That was a New Zealand movie as well. Yeah, really good production. And with this one, it stars Matthew Lewis. So if anyone remembers, he was Neville Longbottom in Harry Potter.
Yes.
And he was much younger then. Like, he's a lot older now. He's really charming in this. And he's the long endearing boyfriend to the main character here, played by Rose Matafeo. She's a New Zealand comedian. And she's great in this. So what happens is, essentially, they're in a long-term relationship. They haven't been married or anything as yet. She falls pregnant, and then all of a sudden she thinks, wait a sec, I've still got my life to live. I've got a bucket list of things to go through. And the baby's like the last thing on her mind. But the funny thing is, the boyfriend, he's stepping up. He's actually doing the thing. I'm going to be a dad, and I'm going to, you know, do the right thing and everything.
So
the point, she's pregnant. She's going to have a baby, and he's doing the right. He's even going like to the baby class. He's on his own and they're going, where's the wife? Oh, sure. That sort of thing. But it's really cool, like an interesting dynamic between
New Zealanders
two.
Have a very special way of doing comedy.
It's
and
good,
I've got to
yeah.
say, was it Shaun of the Dead that they did as well? They've done a lot of humor. No, I've been told no, it wasn't, but I'll tell you what, they are very good at comedy.
Well, Eagle vs. Shark's a good one. That's a classic New Zealand comedy from quite a few years ago, but yeah, it's kind of Australian, but not. They've got their own kind of flavour of comedy, which is a lot of fun. So this one's Baby Done. This is out on the 22nd of October. Mm-hmm. So check that out if you like. Another Australian, Australiana kind of movie we've got coming up is Dirt Music. And it sounds familiar? Well, it's actually a previous novel by Tim Winton. So the whole thing's been adapted. This one's out on the 18th of October. Mm. Now, it also looks kind of familiar when you see it and you go, oh, wait a sec, is that WA? Yes, it was filmed in Esperance.
Was it really?
Yes,
obviously
it looks amazing, yeah. But yeah, this one, it's pretty cool. It's based on the book. It's about a marriage that's kind of gone down the dumps, but she's sort of, deviating from all of that. And then all of a sudden there's this sort of loner guy that travels into town. And he's a kind of used to be a musician, but they sort of seem to find a spark together, but then there's a bit of conflict as well. This is essentially a crime drama because some sort of something happens
In regards to this,
something criminal in nature that happens. But yeah, we've got a lot of Australian and WA actors in this one. Kelly McDonald's the main lady in this one. She does a bit of comedy work as well. And American actor Garrett Hedlund, who I last remember was in like Tron Legacy, he's in this as the main kind of guy that she falls for. And so this sort of strange sort of love triangle thing, crime situation that occurs. But yeah, it's beautiful.
Do you think COVID, Paul, has given the opportunity for movies that probably wouldn't have got a look
That's
in.
That's the whole thing, because essentially, like, you've got all these big blockbusters, but the whole the pattern of them being released and the expectations of it has all kind of fallen asunder, and now we've got, like, all of the little guys, the little independent movies are going, hey, guess what? Look, hey, we're releasing
we're
these anyway. Enjoy. Check them out. So this one's great. Dirt Music, out on the 18th. Directed by Grigor Jordan, who did an awesome movie back in 04 called Ned Kelly, which starred Heath Ledger.
Oh, yeah, that was funny.
But this movie was actually speculated to star Heath Ledger back in the day as well. It was a project from back then as well. So
never happened.
Yeah, so that's Dirt Music.
Okay.
Check out. Yeah, the third one we got is The Outpost. This is kind of a different thing altogether. For those of you that like your sort of... military action type dramas that are based loosely on reality, sort of similar to your Black Hawk Down, that sort of situation. The Outpost is based on a situation in the Afghan War. We have also got in this one Scott Eastwood, son of Clint Eastwood. He's good. Like, he's pretty cool in this. Like, he plays this role quite well. So just like
I didn't even know he had a son that was an actor.
Just like his dad. Like, he's got, you know, the acting chops for this sort of action and that. He does a great job. But he's also got Orlando Bloom in this as well. And these soldiers are in a situation in Afghanistan where they've got a village that they're taking care of. The village possibly has dealings with the Taliban, but they're sorting that out. But the thing is, the village is actually based in between these mountainsides. And every now and then, you know, various terrorist groups are shooting at them and everything. And they're going, any day now, some major conflict's going to happen right here, and we're in the middle of it, so what's going to happen?
Always time for a good war movie.
Yes, yeah, this one is, it looks it good. Looks it's good. A huge bit of action
Black
in that one.
Widow, eh?
Oh, yeah, well, The Outpost is out on the 8th of October.
8th of October,
that's sooner
very
later.
Soon. Yep.
So Black Widow, which is like part of the whole Marvel Universe thing. Now, this
now, is this one you said was delayed?
Well, it's been delayed. Year? Originally, it was meant to be out in May this year. This is Black Widow, who's one of the characters in the whole Avengers thing that they kind of just shoved into the Avengers, but she was originally in Iron Man 2, played by Scarlett Johansson. They thought, oh, this is actually an interesting character that we want to put in. So with Black Widow, there's been several trailers out. It was originally meant to be out May of this year, and then they were delaying it. So as far as I know, it was meant to be November this year. But now, because technically the only Marvel-type movie that came out this year was The New Mutants, which didn't do too well, and that was kind of a Fox thing. So all this year, there hasn't actually been like a big blockbuster Disney Marvel Universe movie being released.
Yep.
And for them, they said, well, look, we don't want to even put it out on streaming for anyone. This movie's done and it's ready for everyone to enjoy. And so with Black Widow, which is actually a prequel to all of these, it's telling you how Natasha Romanoff, Black Widow, became her character and got involved in the whole thing. There's a lot of other stars in this. Florence Pugh is an up-and-coming star. David Harbour from Stranger Things is in it. And also Rachel Wise is in it. And even Robert Downey Jr. appears in this briefly as Tony
Big
Stark,
cast.
Apparently.
Good cast.
Huge cast, interesting people.
Do you reckon
in this
it might
one.
Come out at Christmas?
I would like to for it to come out this year at some time. But they're even now speculating, oh, no, we're just going to put it back a year and then May next year, which people are saying that's a little bit
And see,
crazy.
You've also got Melbourne that is out and you've got 7 million people there. And if even if 3 million go to watch the movie, it makes big money. And if they're not able to go to the cinema, you'd want to hold it off until next year,
it's
I guess.
It's so strange because for them, like, they have the movie ready. It's locked up, ready to go. But
it's
for them, they find a change of the day for it. So Black Widow, which is the next big Marvel movie, might not be out until next year, unfortunately.
Thank you very much,
yes,
Paul.
Thanks, Fred.
Have you been watching anything big on Netflix or any of the streaming this week?
Not, for me, it's just been two shows, which is like Raised by Wolves and The Boys. They're the only ones
Your
I really favorite. Like. But yeah,
sounds good. Well, thank you very much to Paul Elwin for movies. And I've got some tickets to give away. Thanks to Palace Cinema. Folks, we are giving away, today I'm giving away four platinum tickets. That's the Gold Lounge tickets, but better. Platinum tickets if you want to go down to see the new Rain Square Cinema. Looks very similar to this, as they all look luxurious. Leather seating, great cafes, nice food, great wine, and a safe place, great parking as well. You get $5 parking. You just punch your card when you go up to the cinema, and you only pay $5 instead of the normal, maybe $10 or $12. Palace Cinema, all you have to do to win these tickets is SMS us the code word to 0439 929 929. The code word is always going to be Palace, so remember that every week. It doesn't matter where you are in Australia except for Melbourne, because you can't use it there at the moment unless they open up very quickly. There's the code word, 0439 929 929. Name and address must be placed on that as well. Thank you to Palace Cinema as well for sponsoring the segment, and thank you for them giving us the tickets to give away. Paul, thank you very much for being on the show.
Thank you,
And we'll catch up with you in a couple of weeks' time.
Yep, with more movies.
We're going to take a break, and we'll probably even do streaming then. We'll take a break, be back with more of The Couch right after this. Stay with us. Welcome back to The Couch. Time to talk Red Zoo. We've got him here, Ranger Red. Welcome back to The Couch.
Thanks for having us, friend.
And we've got a special guest, Dr. Susie. Welcome for the first time on The Couch.
Yes, it is.
Nice to have you here.
Thank you very much.
We're going to find out why Dr. Susie is here today, but you've also got a friend sitting there, and that's Bernice.
Yeah, it's Bernice the St. Bernard. So I know she's not a normal zoo animal. You know I'm very good at making my dreams come true, and after seeing a St. Bernard on a country practice as a kid, I knew I'd have one day, and there's a special reason why I have Bernice at the zoo is because Bernice, being a St. Bernard, they're most famous for rescuing people in the Swiss Alps because they belong to the Hospice of St. Bernard.
Yes.
And animals obviously have therapeutic natures that help people. Obviously with St. Bernards, it was rescuing them when they were buried in the snow and that. So she's kind of an ambassador animal for one of the reasons why you might want to come to the zoo.
Fantastic. Now, Dr. Susie, welcome. Yeah,
thank you.
Now, I know you've got a background as a medical doctor.
I have, yeah.
But you're also a horse lover. You've got your own horses. Yes. You're also an actress.
Yes.
You've done many, many things in life. But today we're referring to your medical side.
Sure. Yeah.
What are the benefits of having pets?
Massive benefits. In my work as a GP, I always ask about, you know, people's pets. I think I was saying to you before, the ancient Greeks were the first people that recognised the beneficial effects of animals, you know, in treating sickness and things like that. So cats and dogs, their purr has shown to be beneficial. It actually, because when the cats purr, they release endorphins. Mm-hmm. And then when we're holding them and they're purring,
they make you feel relaxed
and
safe.
They really do.
It's like having a baby on.
Yeah. So it's shown to promote bone healing, tissue healing, decreases blood pressure, decreases your risk of having a heart attack, all manner of things. And I'm also involved in what's called equine therapy. So that's using horses to help people through mental health issues and post-traumatic stress and all sorts of things.
Especially with COVID-19, and not so much in WA, but in recent days we've been okay. But people in Victoria, I could imagine the elderly that are stuck in nursing homes and they're not seeing many people. If they've got a pet, it would actually be like...
Oh, so beneficial.
It'd be wonderful,
amazing.
Wouldn't it?
And there are things about animals that we just can't, we have no idea about. You know, I used to work in a country hospital and we had a cat who used to go in and sit on people's beds in the hospice area of the hospital. And within a couple of hours, they'd pass away.
You know, my mum had a heart attack a long time ago, maybe 5 or 6 years ago. And we weren't allowed at Royal Perth to take in a real pet, obviously.
Yeah.
So I bought my mum a stuffed cat, and my mum had dementia.
Yeah.
But my mum used to talk to this cat, and the hospital actually called me in and said, "Your mum's got an animal with her." And I said, "No, it's a stuffed animal." But they said, "Oh, they never even bothered to look." And you know what? The benefits of having that stuffed toy, and when you've got dementia, reality sometimes escapes you, and I think it's best to go with it.
Yes,
let the patient believe it is a real cat, and if it gives them some pleasure, some relief and happiness, go with it.
Yeah.
So you're doing work with Red Zoo?
Yes. Well, I'm sort of lurking around at times, and I mean, you know, we have a dog there, but there's a little pony, and I just, you know, they're natural.
I reckon he just wants to be in another edition of A Country Practice.
I think that's a wonderful idea. But I say animals are nature's antidepressants. They really are, you know. And if it's visiting Red Zoo and, you know, interacting, look, even with a snake, you know, I mean, it's beneficial.
Now, there's lots of animals at your zoo.
Yes.
So how many of those animals can people actually hold and touch and maybe even feed?
Okay, so on the board at the zoo for the school holidays and weekends, we have lamb feeding, snake handling, frolicking with ferrets, lounging with a lizard, getting up close and with a betong, and obviously, you know, you could even Pat Ranger Eddie if you wanted to, and obviously meeting Bernice.
Do you have to feed him as well?
Yes, you actually do quite regularly, otherwise okay. It gets a bit hangry, don't you, darling? And
does Bernice hang around the zoo as well?
She does. She's one of the first animals you'll meet because her enclosure is literally at our front door.
She's a little bit lazy today, isn't she?
She's relaxed.
She's worn out after meeting all your guests.
And this is what she can do to people. I mean, the elderly, people who are not well. How wonderful as a pet.
It really is.
Not so much rescue today.
No.
I think hopefully I don't fall over and she has to rescue me because I'm pretty much stuffed. But look, animals are wonderful. Red Zoo is amazing.
Yeah.
You've got the school holidays coming up.
We have. Yeah,
what have we got going on during the school holidays?
All those encounters that I was just explaining to you about before and that.
How do people get involved? Now, the kids just come down every day?
You rock up and from 10 o'clock through to 3 o'clock, those activities run right throughout the day. And the other one I forgot was, we now walk Athena around the zoo for half an hour, who we had in the last show, so you can get to meet her. Yeah.
Any new additions to the zoo? I know we talked about your Tasmanian devil.
Yeah, we got a pony the other day. So another one of my dreams come true, and it wasn't a miniature pony because I didn't want a miniature pony. Dr. Susie's partner, Nigel, brought me down a little Shetland pony stallion.
Beautiful.
Who belonged to two elderly ladies who needed to find him a home when they realised they couldn't look after him anymore. So you can find Presley in our picnic area.
Presley.
Fantastic. Now tell me where the zoo is. For those people who are saying, Red Zoo, used to be known as Peel Zoo. Mm-hmm. It's too big now, too famous, so we've had to change the name. And you've got Red right there, Ranger Red. So tell us where you are.
We are in Pinjarra. It's on number 1 Sanctuary Drive, which is just behind the Pinjarra Golf Course. So as you travel down the freeway, turn left onto Pinjarra Road as if you're driving into Pinjarra, and turn off onto Sutton Drive behind the golf course and you'll find us.
And what times are you open?
We're open from 9 till 5.
And is there a lot of activities there for kids during the school holidays as well? Are you having maybe some face painting and stuff like that, or not yet?
Not yet, but with all the other activities we've got going on.
Do you have ice cream?
We do.
You are just a saviour. I don't need Bernice. You just saved me yourself with the ice cream. Look, it's a lot of fun. And I've got to say to people, the reason the zoo is a wonderful place, the Perth Zoo, but it's so big, so not personal, I guess, for me. And I think Red Zoo, the thing I love about it, it's intimate. Mm. The animals are closer to you. Mm. I love the habitat. You really worry about the way the animals live.
Yeah.
So you the enclosure is amazing. Mm. And you do such an amazing job. You've got such great staff down there that are passionate.
We
and
do.
Some amazing animals that you probably wouldn't see at the Perth Zoo.
And one of the things we do offer, especially for the school holidays, if you actually want to lose your kids for a day, you can book them in to be keeper for a day. You drop the kids off at 10 a.m, pick them up at 3 p.m, they get a hat, a cap, fed by us, and they get to do every job a zookeeper would do for a day.
What a great way of employing the kids. And it's like being a job keeper. You're just at the zoo. What a wonderful, I'll write that down for the treasurer. And look, it's fantastic. And if people love being part of the zoo,
they
like
do.
Dr. Yeah. Susie, obviously.
I really do.
You know, I would have thought you'd prefer to take the Betty Care card. The world is changing, Dr. Susie.
I know.
Is there a need for volunteers as well? If people want to come and volunteer, do you need any volunteers?
We just did our volunteer intake, so our next one will be in 3 months.
There you go. You missed out. You should have been quicker. But look, keep in touch with the zoo. The website is wonderful as well. What's the website?
www.rangerred@peelzoo.com.au.
Just checking the screen. Yes.
No, it's redzoo.com.au.
Next time you come in, we'll have a quiz.
Yeah.
Let's see, is it A or B? Thank you very much. Look, Ranger Red, you are a wonderful talent. Congratulations on the zoo. Bernice, thank you for coming in. No need to get up. And, of course, Dr. Susie, you're a very interesting lady. I'd love to have you back on the show.
I'd love to come
You
back.
Add a lot to the idea of a zoo being wonderful for people's health.
It is. It's wonderful, yeah. Thank you.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
How do we get a hold of you? Someone wants to have you in there acting.
Oh,
maybe Neighbours?
Sure. Actors Management International, and I've also got a website, and contact me on Facebook or Instagram.
Fantastic.
Thank you
very much, Dr. Susie. Thank you. Red. We will talk to them next month. A big announcement, he tells me, next month, so stay tuned. We'll be taking a break here on the couch and back with more of the couch right after this. Stay with us. Wow. Welcome back to The Couch. Just a reminder, folks, if you check out our online edition of this episode of The Couch on our Facebook page or thecouch.com.au, you will get not only the normal couch, but you will get a lot extra as well. A little bit of a surprise. There's a lot of stuff there that doesn't make it on the TV show, and we add it on online as well. So please check out our website, thecouch.com.au. It is our Facebook page, and like I said, there's more stuff there. As always, we keep you entertained and informed. A time now to talk entertainment, and as always, he's on the couch once again, the man that knows everything about entertainment, and Ellen DeGeneres.
Yes, my
it
best
is, of
friend.
Course, Alexander Sakosta.
Yes.
Welcome
stand
back.
With.
Thank you very much. Are you one of the 270 staff that she has responsibility over?
Yes, and we have not been paid to say that she's a nice person. She is a nice person, and we love her.
And can I just say at the end of the segment, you're doing TV as well on,
yes,
for another network.
No, sorry, everyone. Like, I love my Aurora and my community channel. I'm on Channel 7 on Home in WA at the moment as well.
And you've just started. Now, you can catch that show, folks, if you want to catch Alexander Sakosta. What sort of interviews have you done? Where have you gone?
We had the Finbar Group for the Civic Heart Development in South Perth, and then I was at the River Gums in Baldivis recently.
Wonderful. You enjoying it?
Yeah.
And, of course, that's at 5 p.m. on a Saturday afternoon on Hard to say that number.
Hard to say.
That number 7. Thank you very much. And good luck with that. And
thank
keep
you
us
very
informed
much,
and we'll promote that as well.
Appreciate it.
You've got lots of stories to talk about. What's happening with the Emmys?
The Emmys. So 2020 Emmys were obviously very different thanks to COVID. So they were all like multiple cameras set up all across LA with each of people in their homes. And what was really kind of cool is that the statuettes, so they had people in these like hazmat suits, which would look like tuxedos, holding the statuettes in case that person won. So none of the people knew if they'd won still. Hey, and then apparently, as opposed to if you didn't win, the person with the statuette would just wave and leave.
I saw that. There was one outside the door.
Yeah, outside everyone's
and
door.
And he just walked away.
Yeah, they just walk away and they wave. So I was just like, I'm sorry, bye.
You didn't win.
Oh, you're so close and then so far.
Any surprises out of the Emmys?
It was so interesting to see the Canadian show Schitt's Creek won quite a few, which is such a funny show, so I'm kind of glad.
It is a funny show. Very funny.
So
is it the guy that's
Eugene
the main
Levy.
Actor?
Yeah.
He was in, was it American Pie?
Correct, yes. Yeah, he was the dad in American Pie. And him and his son created the show together.
They look exactly the same.
They do look very similar. The eyebrows.
The eyebrows.
But yeah, so glad to see that one win. And The Watchmen won a lot of awards. Surprisingly, Reese Witherspoon's show, Little Fires Everywhere, didn't win very much. Because I thought that was really good. I don't know if you saw it, Fred. I really enjoyed that. So
did you really? Because I've had feedback. It's not as funny as people thought it would be.
Little Fires Everywhere? Mm. Oh, it's not meant to be a comedy, so that's probably good feedback.
Doesn't she
on
have
the Emmys.
Isn't it? Maybe I'm thinking of Drew. No, I'm thinking of Drew Barrymore.
Oh, you're thinking of Drew Barrymore.
She's got her own little chat
that
show that was supposed
that was
to go up against Ellen.
Up with the other Charlie's Angels, and then apparently they went all together. That was
interesting things are happening over there. Anything else you want to say about the Emmys?
No, I think it was actually, I kind of enjoyed watching it. I thought they did a good job. Jen Aniston was very funny. Jimmy Kimmel. Yeah. It's the best you can do. You made good of a good situation.
So. I think it was fantastic. Yeah. So Thomas Hardy, rumoured as a new James Bond.
So obviously Daniel Craig's last James Bond film, which is coming out soon in December, will be his final one. And the replacement is potentially, this is what the betting people are saying, Tom Hardy. So
now tell us a bit about him for those people who don't know.
Don't know him. Probably best known, at least kind of from a corporate sense, as Bane in Batman. You know that one where he's covered in the face?
Yeah, yep.
Don't you just see James Bond when you see that?
No, I see very dark. The new Batman's very dark.
Oh, super dark in that. But as an actor, I think he'll do a really good job because it's, again, trying to shift. I actually think Daniel Craig did a fantastic job, so I think you want to reinvent the character with each kind of person who takes it on, and I think someone as serious an actor as Tom Hardy would do actually a fantastic job. So I'm actually looking forward to if he is the person they're going to choose.
Do you reckon he will?
I think so. The betting agencies say so, and I kind of think so too. The right age to kind of do another 4 or 5 films as James Bond.
We'll look out for that one. Let us know when it becomes official, as you always do.
I'm on the pulse.
What's Tom Cruise been up to?
So Tom Cruise is going to shoot a movie in space because, of course he is, Fred, because once you've conquered, you know, Hollywood and the globe,
and
you've got
Earth.
To go interstellar. Yeah, so he'll become like the best actor in the universe. he's going to shoot a movie in space in 2021. So he's going up for a flight very soon to kind of just get used to being in space, and then they're going to shoot it next year, 2021, the first film to actually be shot in space.
Well, being a Scientologist, you're virtually in space all the time, aren't you?
What are you talking about,
nothing
Fred?
At all, nothing at all. I heard
please
this rumour. So Tom Cruise still doing it with movies. And
you redefine yourself, really, as an actor. Like, you'll become well-known. Like, he's already a superstar.
Do you reckon
maybe
the next Star Wars?
He's literally a star already, so he's just returning to the sky where he belongs.
And what's happening with Tiger King?
Tiger King, Carol Baskin was on Dancing with the Stars. Now, allegedly, she murdered her husband, Don Lewis. If you watch Tiger King, did you watch Tiger King?
I haven't, but I actually saw it on WA good. Today. I read the story.
Yeah.
Interesting.
A lot
of controversy over the show.
Very controversial because basically she changed the will like 2 days before he vanished. And then the whole thing of when she was on Dancing with the Stars is the children of Don had paid for advertising during the show to actually like make claims against her.
Oh, wow.
So it's like this moment, which is meant to be about her, is very much about, once again, she can't leave this in her past.
She's got an amazing background, this lady, hasn't she?
That show, Fred, every single one of them is a character. There's like every single person who worked at that zoo is just like has a story.
And who's the guy that's gone off to jail?
The Tiger King himself.
Yep.
His name escapes me, right?
Yeah, but he's gone to...
Joe Exotic, that's right.
Thank you. Floor manager there?
Yeah. He's a character. Him and his many husbands.
Okay. And he's gone to jail.
Yeah, he's in prison right now.
Because he did some bad
still.
Things as well.
Yeah. Oh, he did a lot of things, allegedly.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Convicted. Anything else you want to tell us today?
No, I just thought it was interesting that she danced to Eye of the Tiger as opposed to It Wasn't Me. I thought that would have been a better choice.
And I'm assuming you've watched the new Ellen series?
Yeah, I watched her apology.
How do you reckon the apology went? Hey, she got a lot of criticism.
Well, that's the thing. It's like you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. She said she was sorry. She says she's making changes. She says like how could she be this person that she's been alleged to be for all of this time without anyone really noticing? She goes, the person I am on TV is very close to the person I am as a person.
But she did say at one point, did you hear her say, I'm an actor. I'm a very good actor.
Yeah.
And I thought, does that mean you're a liar and you're not real? But then I realised what she meant is that's just a job. This one part of it.
I mean, someone's mean in Hollywood. Let's be real.
I agree with
you. Maybe the story should be someone was nice in Hollywood.
Very true. Alexander Sacosta, anything else in entertainment that's happening?
No, that's pretty much it for this week.
Well, you have yourself a wonderful couple of weeks. Good luck again with this wonderful TV show that
you're doing.
On Channel 7 called Home in WA.
Home in WA.
5 o'clock on a Saturday on 7. Look forward to catching it myself and seeing how you go. We're going to go to a music act. We've got a lovely lady, Isabel, or Izzy as we call her here at the couch. She's got a beautiful song. It's called Dance Monkey. Here she is, centre stage. Thank you very much, Izzy. Well done. And we'll see you at the end of the show with another song, Izzy, or we call it Isabel. Green, that is, if you're wondering. Please support her, local talent, local people, made in Perth as well, which is really, really important. Somebody else that's made in Perth is Julia Seymour from RAC Arena Events. Welcome back.
Thanks for having me back.
Now, you have had lots happening. One of my good friends, Kylie, was at the RAC Arena and I missed it. But you know what? For those people who went, I bet they loved the show.
Fred, I have to tell you, it wasn't the real Kylie Minogue. It was absolute Kylie. But she was phenomenal. She was last night and she was so good, really got the party started, had everyone dancing. Oh, I loved it.
She's a wonderful performer. Mm-hmm. We've actually had her a couple of shows as well. She's incredibly good at what she does. And you were saying off air how close to Kylie Minogue's voice she is. Mm-hmm. And she's got all the moves and all that. And if you missed that, don't worry, there's bigger shows coming because you've got three major shows coming at RAC Arena. Let's talk about the stage.
Right, well, the stage we've had for a little while now, but we've just extended its run, which is very exciting. It's entertainment every Thursday, Friday and Saturday nights in our RAC local lounge.
And it's fantastic because you can get drinks, food, great comedy, great musicians and lots of stuff, lots of
Absolutely.
Fun.
Absolutely.
And the food is high quality food. What time does that open?
So on Thursdays and Friday nights, it opens from 3:30 p.m. until late.
Beautiful.
And then Saturdays is ticketed events and we open the doors from 6:30 and then we'll just party through for the rest of the night.
Wonderful. And you said that there it is on screen. How good does that look, that pizza and those hamburgers? Oh, I tell you, you need a food taster. I'm available.
Are you free?
Yeah, look, I'm vegetarian, but I'm happy to switch.
We'll make it work.
It looks really, really good. It looks wonderful. Now, they've extended it for how long?
Until the end of October, so there's Beautiful. Still plenty of time to come and check it out.
Let's hope they keep it going even to Christmas, because I reckon it'd be awesome with Christmas trees everywhere, Santa Claus to greet the kids
Absolutely.
And the families.
Absolutely.
But that's not the only thing. Pixar Putt.
Mm-hmm.
What's that all about?
Well, Pixar Putt has just come back to Perth Arena. Mm. Well, sorry, Perth at the RAC Arena. It's very exciting. It's on the plaza, so outside in
yes.
the sun, and it's right over the school holidays. It's 9 or 18 holes, and
there
you can just come on down and enjoy it. It's all your favourite Pixar characters. So, you know, we've got Finding Nemo, The Incredibles, Monsters, Inc., A Bug's Life, Toy Story, all your favourites.
Now, that started on the 25th of September.
That's right.
And it runs through the 25th of October.
Mm-hmm.
So do we need to pay for tickets? Because you can get the tickets at Ticketek, don't we?
That's right,
it's probably
yes.
quicker to pre-buy them.
Mm-hmm. Or you can find them online at rsarena.com.au.
Well done. And have you had a game of putt-putt yourself?
I actually had a go last year. I haven't had a try this season yet, but I'm very excited because last year, look, I've got a long way to go before I'm going to make the pros. So, you know, I think I'm ready to have my redemption round.
And I do love these events. I think it involves you can bring the whole family or just a group of friends. And as we said, great venue because you can still get food and drinks after you do your putt-putt. You go inside and have something to eat.
We actually have snacks and drinks outside. So you can just
like
stay right on the court. Yep, that's right.
What a wonderful idea. Do you need any food tasters for that one?
Ooh, we'll see what
we
can do.
I can put my name down to all of these. Look. This guy here, this magician, is an amazing guy. He's called Kazam the Magic Man.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us a little bit about him because I've seen a lot of write-ups and he's wonderful.
Yes, our Kazam the Magic Man is pretty special and he is coming to the RAC Local Lounge to perform for the kids of Perth. It's going to be amazing. And actually, Fred, we do have some exciting news. We've just extended the run. So we have added two extra shows on Thursday the 8th, 10 a.m. and 1 p.m.
Yep.
So you can come and check it out. If you haven't got tickets yet, now's the perfect time
to
get them.
So it's going to be running on the 7th, the 8th, the 9th, the 10th of October. Tickets are only $10. So don't be a tidy. The kids are on holidays.
Mm-hmm.
We'd love you to come down and have a wonderful day there. And look, the putt-putt can be for the whole family.
Absolutely.
The stage could be for the parents when they need to unwind and relax when the kids are asleep. And you've got Kazam the Magic Man doing some magic act and it's going to be fantastic. Now, where is that going to be? Is that inside the actual arena or is that?
That's right. It's in the RAC Local Lounge. So it's still part of the arena, but just to the side. It's nice and small and inclusive and it's just perfect for a bit of magic.
You know what? Our very own RAC Arena doing amazing things, amazing events. And if you've got an act which you think it's worthwhile, everybody's seeing it, contact RAC Arena because you never know. They could be looking for a special act. And they're wonderful. Local people doing local things.
That's right.
Well done. Anything else you want to tell us?
Just come on down, check out our website and see what's going on because we have so much happening at the moment.
And there it is on screen, RAC Arena. roc.com.au. That's rocarena.com.au. A wonderful venue. Lots of things happening in the new year. Look forward to that, but there's lots of things happening now. Thank you to Julia Seymour. We'll see you maybe before the end of the year.
Sounds good.
We'll take a big break on the couch and come back with more. We've got Bitchin' with our team coming up next.
Connect with The Couch online through Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube.
Welcome back to The Couch. I hope you've enjoyed the show today. It's going to get even bigger now. We've got some amazing guests for you to meet. I have got a little gift from Hilary Lane, who's a naturopath and pharmacist. It's a great product that helps you go to sleep. Nisha's going to be talking to Hilary Lane. Thank you for bringing in the gift. Over to you, Nisha.
Thank you so much, Fred. A really good friend of The Couch, Hilary Lane. Welcome back.
Thank you very much. It seems as if I'm part of the furniture now. The couch is feeling very comfortable.
Well, you're much better looking than the furniture.
That's good.
And obviously a really clever lady. So your background is a pharmacist, but more recently naturopath.
That's right.
And yes. So maybe just for the audience, just to give a very quick snapshot of what you do, who you are, and then we'll get straight into our segment on sleep.
Well, what I do now is see patients and solve their health problems. Mm-hmm. And if I can make something for them, custom made, then I will. And that's using my pharmacy background. Yes. And so that brings us to the sleep segment that we've got today and how important sleep is. Mm. And I can actually make a few potions for sleep.
Potions, I like the sound of that.
Potions, yes.
And we're not talking about wine or any kind of non-prescriptive drug.
No, we're talking about natural herbs.
Yes.
If people actually can't get to sleep and they've tried all the very good health things, and then I can actually make them a sleep tonic that will help calm them down and get them to sleep.
So before we get started on the tonic or talking through a balm that I have a sample of here, can you tell us, I guess if you come for a consultation, what types of things that you look at in regards to sleep to then make that diagnosis?
Well, we would actually look at their lifestyle and how stressed they are, what commitments they've got, what hours they're working, and then what is causing the sleep problem. Has it been a lifelong thing, or is it just a very new thing? Yeah. And then if it's a very new thing, we try and say, well, okay, you need to practice the sleep hygiene.
Yes.
See if that works, and if that doesn't work, then I'll make you up a tonic. But we might actually then prescribe something that'll actually help them calm down a little bit as well.
Beautiful. I think that that's so important. You have a really thorough approach at the start. A myth that I just want answered for myself as well, because as a psychologist I talk a lot about sleep, but a lot of clients come in and they say, well, I'm fine with 4 hours, I'm fine with 6 hours or 8 hours. Is there a golden time? What should we be sleeping every night?
Well, it depends on the person. Teenagers need a lot more sleep. They can need 12 to 14 hours because they're growing.
Yes.
But the golden thing is to sleep between 12 midnight and 3 a.m.
Oh, okay.
And if you only need 6 hours, it's got to include those 3 hours.
Okay, so really your daily routine and making sure you're winding down before is very important.
So you're winding down from about 10 o'clock.
Okay.
And you're getting off your computer, your tablet, your phone, and you're leaving them outside your bedroom. You don't want any blue or red lights in your bedroom.
Okay.
And you want to have a nice warm shower or have a nice drink of chamomile tea or peppermint tea, calm you down, but not too bigger an amount.
Okay.
Magnesium, the right kind of magnesium can actually help you sleep as well.
Okay.
So,
what about if you wake up at night?
Well, why have you woken up? Is it because you've had too much to drink during the evening?
Definitely not me, no.
No, water as well as alcohol.
Or cups of
tea, or you might have had too many cups of tea in the evening.
Yes, correct. That's
and you might have to get up and wee several times. But if you do get up and wee several times, you might also have a medical problem that you've got to watch out for. So it might be diabetes, or if you're male, a prostate problem.
Yeah, I was also just thinking in my mind around if you're in bed for longer than 20 minutes and you're not sleeping, I've often heard experts say get up because you start to actually form a memory of not sleeping in your bed, which is what you don't want.
Get up and start the process all over again.
And then
you'll usually then do something different, have your cup of tea or use the sleep balm or take an extra dose of magnesium. And then you're back in bed again and make sure it's nice and comfortable.
Beautiful. Now, let's talk about your sleep balm because having the pharmaceutical background, we can be very confident that you know what you're doing in terms of the mix. Can you tell us a bit about what's in the sleep balm and how we use it?
Well, it's got a nice natural base that is moisturising with no preservatives or anything in it. And then it's got the oils in it. And then, watch out, Nisha's going to fall asleep. But you can apply it just by your ears, under your throat, on your throat there, under your jaw, on your chest. If you don't fall asleep soon, you can do it again. You can even put it under your nostrils because it actually smells very nice and it's got no toxins in it whatsoever.
Wonderful. Oh, beautiful. Well, it does smell absolutely amazing. Where can people buy the sleep balm?
At the moment, only from Ultra Health Centre, my work.
Okay, and tell us about Ultra Health Centre for those that may not know.
Ultra Health Centre is a health clinic in Floreat where I work, and I have a few other people working from there as well. But I also have a couple of dispensaries from there making herbs or making potions like the sleep balm. And we open normal shop hours.
Good, wonderful.
And Saturday mornings. Yeah.
Well, very confident, you know, your academic background, your practice background, your experience in life and all the balms, you're going to be continuing to come on the couch, which is exciting. Can you tell everyone where to find out more, perhaps your website?
Ultrahealthcentre.com.au and we're at 215 Selby Street in Floreat.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for joining us again, Hilary.
Thanks very much for having me.
And well done all the great work that you're continuing to do.
Thank you.
And we'll see you very soon.
We'll see you soon.
Wonderful.
Okay.
Now, if you've missed any of that, of course, you can go to thecouch.com.au or our Facebook page. But for now, it's back to you, Fred.
Thank you very much to Hilary and to Nisha. We'll catch up with you very soon, Hilary. Now, poor Elwin is centre stage doing something that we call Tai Chi. Now, if you wanted to know more, there's a fantastic day out that's coming up very soon. They're having a workshop. It is, of course, Heaven Man Earth Perth. And over to you, Paul and Julius.
Thank you very much, Fred. I'm here with Julius from Heaven Man Earth in Perth. And Julius, what do you do at Heaven Man Earth in Perth? And I understand that we have an open day coming up on the 11th of October.
Yes, so we're a Tai Chi school, so we teach Tai Chi. And yes, we have an open day coming up where we're going to invite everyone for a free class so they can get an experience of it for themselves. And we're going to try all different aspects of Tai Chi, a handful of different exercises so people can get a feeling for themselves and be able to relax the body and get
a sense of it. So I understand like Tai Chi isn't like, you know, when you have martial arts, people go, oh, it's just all fighting and learning how to fight people and self-defense. From what I understand, Tai Chi, with the Chi part of it, it's all about internal and energy as well?
Exactly, So Tai Chi has the fighting aspect, the health aspect, and the spiritual aspect. So yes, we do learn positions and techniques that are for martial art and developing martial art, but we're also, you know, in the long term, primarily, really, it's about releasing the stress away from our body and building our Chi, which kind of charges our battery up so that we feel better as we get older, not run out of energy, and we get better balance and we get more stable, you know, so we're sort of improving as we go rather than getting hurt.
Cool. So I understand we've got Brett and Ash here to do a bit of a demo in a bit of the movement as well, and you're going to show us some technique as well.
Yeah, so they're going to help me out with something we call Sung Gung, which is about loosening the joints. Oh, okay. So we'll give you a little look.
Cool.
So we're just letting go of the tension in the shoulders, and there's also an internal coordination that goes on with this, that once we get the shape, then after that we'll learn that part. And
so this is something anyone can learn and do and get involved in, that hence the open day is for everybody
absolutely
to check out.
Absolutely, yeah. Cool. Everyone's welcome to come along.
So what are they doing at the moment? They're getting their shape, they're getting the actual technique
exactly,
together, is it?
Exactly. Yeah. So we learn the shape so that basically we're creating a good container so that as we release all the tension, then eventually the energy can circulate through our body. So if we're sort of in an awkward shape,
like every day, like, you know, if you're at the office or any sort of work, you're getting stressed out and then some people go like, I have no idea how to sort out my stress or release.
Absolutely.
So this is definitely a healthy way to
Yeah, work I mean, out. Life is kind of against us. You know, we have old injuries, we have age, time goes on, we get a bit tighter. You know, if we have a tight spot, if we don't deal with it, 2 years, 5 years later, it will be sort of worse. So this gives us the personal tools that, yeah, if you come home from the office, you've got stress, it's a way to let all that go.
Cool.
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. That's a pretty cool technique. And from what I understand on the website as well, there's another sort of technique or aspect, which is the push hands as well. And I saw a bit of a demo of it on YouTube. Is that something that they'll show on the day as well?
Do a demonstration of that. And we'll also do a little bit of partner exercises, some simple stuff anyone can learn.
Yeah.
But I can give you a little demonstration if you like. The push hands is how we start to learn the martial art applications. But we try to bring all the other solo aspects of training, of staying straight, released, try to bring that into the partner training.
So Tai Chi has the aspect where you're on your own doing the movements, but this is also, they'll get to do this on the day as well, where they're interacting with another person. Yeah.
Yeah, the solo training is the most important stuff, but then as you see, you can also apply things.
Whoa.
Oh, sorry. And you can go say hi to him for a sec.
Nice. So is this like the idea of like conservation of energy, technique and everything? Like you're making it kind of seem like it's an effortless movement.
That's right.
In a way, yeah.
You're trying to not use tension, just use technique.
Cool. And they'll get to see this on the open day, like how this works and everything.
Okay.
So what are the main benefits? Like obviously anybody can do this and try this, but for them, is it mainly health? But also I've got a friend who does it. He told me that like when he... First, before he did it, he was like unco and a little bit off balance all the time. But for him, it actually helped him sort of develop better physical coordination. Yeah,
absolutely. So we're developing, embodying the principle of yin and yang. And one of the ways we do that is by we're on one leg. This is solid. This is empty. And then we change to the other leg. And in doing so, we actually strengthen the legs a lot and we develop being a lot better balanced. So that's another one of those things that as we get older really helps us, but obviously it's helped because we move everything at once in the body, so you do develop coordination, better coordination.
Cool. Yeah. And so for anyone that's getting stressed out as well, for them, they can obviously take all these techniques and, you know, help their own mindset as well as physically.
Absolutely. It has a meditative aspect to it because we have to stay focused internally, so that's why it's called an internal art. So I have to think about what's going on? What's going on with my posture? Am I maintaining my posture? So even though I might be looking out here, which we do in martial art, I maintain my awareness inside, and then that becomes quite meditative, as well as the Tai Chi form. You have to remember what move is next. So if you're thinking about lunch the next day, it kind of doesn't work. So
Discipline, you do have to think about your movement.
It helps
as well,
develops your concentration as well. Yeah.
Oh, that's great. Well, it's cool that we've got Ash and Brett showing as well.
Yeah.
So the open day, from what I understand, it's at Mount Hawthorne Town Hall. It's on the 11th of October between 9:30 to 11:30 a.m. And you can pre-register at 9:15, so you can come in a bit early.
Yep.
And check it out, and then you're going to see all of this and also a lot of demonstration. But they get to be hands-on.
Yeah, exactly.
As well,
yep. They'll learn
cool.
some things that they can take home with them that'll help them for themselves.
Oh, that's great. And the website is heavenmanearthperth.com.au.
Exactly.
And they can check out all of the information and the times and everything for upcoming classes as well.
Yeah, and there's a button there to register for the day so that you can reserve your spot.
Awesome. Oh, that's fantastic. Thanks so much, Julius, and Ash and Brett as well.
Yep. Thank you guys for coming in. Thanks for having us, Fred. And thanks so much.
Thank you. Back to you, Fred.
Thank you very much, Paul. A wonderful event coming up in Perth very soon. Check out their website. Now, something that's coming up in Perth on the 17th of October is the City of Perth elections for a brand new council. One of those people running for council is the man who runs Friends Restaurant here in Perth, Clyde Bevan. Talking to him is our very own Nisha.
Thank you so much, Fred. So the City of Perth elections are upon us and extremely exciting to have Clyde Bevan joining us on the couch. Welcome.
Oh, thank you. It's great to be here.
Clyde, an experienced and respected business gentleman here in Perth, a Friends Restaurant. You've also obviously got quite an experienced background on boards. But most importantly, what I heard prior to the show is very passionate around homelessness in Perth. So
sure.
Talk to us about that.
I was chairman of Lottery West for 6 years, and homelessness is something that we need to work on very, very hard. You know, who wants to eat out of a bin? Who wants to sleep on concrete? Who wants to go for weeks on end without a wash? Nobody does. So the fact of the matter is most of these people are mentally ill, so they need some real assistance, and it's incumbent upon us to actually give it to them. And many years ago, up at Sunset House, there was a premises for them. That was closed down. They're sitting out to their families. Their families can't look after them. You know, they need some real assistance, and if we don't do that, well, then we're going to have what we've got now, which is very sad.
And as a councillor, that's a great opportunity for you to use, I guess, your business skill set as well as collaborate with the other councillors. Is that correct, to put some strategies in place?
Well, absolutely. We need to be desperate about what we do. We need to make sure that we work to make sure that these people are being looked after properly. And what will happen is that the streets of Perth will clean up. We'll find that there'll be more shops being leased out. There'll be more people coming into town. So all of a sudden, Perth will be a much better place for us looking after the homeless.
From a humanity perspective, I think starting with the hub of Western Australia, the City of Perth, what have you noticed? Why is it so important to get the City of Perth cleaned up in that regard?
Well, whenever I go away on holidays, I come back to Perth and you come out of the airport and the first thing you notice is the bright blue skies. You notice that Perth is such a beautiful place. And then when you get to the city and it's looking a bit dull, there's people sleeping in doorways, it's looking untidy. We need to make sure that we make it look better because it has huge potential, Perth. It's got wonderful climate, it's got beautiful beaches, it's got great wineries around it, whether it's the Swan Valley or down the Marga River or the Great Southern. There's so many things to do, and Perth is a gateway to that, and there's lots of wonderful hotels now in the centre of Perth, and we're just ready to go.
And you're a very humble gentleman, so I'm going to ask you the question, but with your business background, with your experience on boards, what skill set will you bring to help this happen?
I think when you have a business or when we're with Lottery West, every decision you make is for the benefit of Lottery West. Every decision I make for my business is for my business. It's not for me, it's not for my wife, it's not for the chef, it's for the business. So as a councillor for the City of Perth, you make decisions that are best for the City of Perth. Not because I want to become something else. I don't. I'm just happy to make the City of Perth a wonderful place.
Yeah, good spiritual capital, looking out for the greater good.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And it's got huge potential. I mean, we all know it's got huge potential. It just needs some people there who care.
And what are some other drivers for being a councillor? What does it mean to you in terms of the team you'll be working with? Any other important matters that you think we need to put forward?
I think you get your values from your mum and dad. I can remember many years ago being at the Midland Town Hall selling my dad's roses and dahlias to raise money for the Salvation Army. So you have this social responsibility that you have personally for other people. And with that, my father used to say to me ad nauseum, you always get what you deserve. But at the moment, we're neglecting people and we're getting back what we deserve, sadly, and we need to fix it.
And you've lived your life like we all have, so you've had a great career. We still have a great career, but
thank you.
Tell us about, in terms of you know, a holistic individual. I mean, I have to say personally, when I look at voting for someone on a council seat, you're looking at, has this person really experienced life? Have they not just run a business, a family man, has worked through their career in various entertainment? You know, you've really experienced life, right?
Yeah, and I've had some challenges too. I was chairman of the Swan Valley Tourism Council, chairman of a youth centre. That's another group of people we neglect.
Yes.
Chairman of a senior citizen centre. I wasn't old enough, but I still did it because I was on the Shire of Kalamunda at the time. So I think you bring a number of skills with you, compassion, common sense, and an urgency to do something to make things better than what they are.
And I imagine they're all different cohorts you've just mentioned there in terms of seniors, youth, so really that
and
developmental
business,
and business, yes,
well,
it's different
CEO
knowledge.
Of the Restaurant and Caterers Association as well, so I suppose I was hyperactive. My father used to, when I was a young boy, my father used to come home from work and get my brother and I to run around the house to wear us out so we'd go to sleep that night. So I think there's a degree of that there too.
Well, and a clear purpose to life, helping people, I think. I'm
sure. Hearing, Yeah, we all get what we deserve at the end of the day.
And obviously Basil Zemplis is running for mayor.
Well, I have to say there's two reasons I'm running for mayor. Firstly, I read a quote on Facebook and it said, caring is not enough. You've got to do something. Mm. And that's so true. A lot of people care, but not many people get out there and do something.
Yes.
And then I saw Basil running, and Basil's an impressive person. He gets put down as a commentator, but Basil's much better than that. And the city of Perth will find out one day, if he's elected, that he's going to be one of the few statesmen that we've ever had. Mm. And but most of all about Basil, other than being a great communicator, he's an achiever. He gets things done, and we desperately need to get things done in Perth. We just can't keep floundering like we are.
Someone with strong human and social capital, and it sounds like you've obviously got that yourself as well. Anything else that you would like to mention to the public or the audience, perhaps where to find out more about you?
Well, more about me, or they look at my Facebook page. I'm a bit obsessed with putting things on Facebook, and there's lots of photos when I was at school and lots of rock bands that perform in my restaurant. I love communicating with people. It's a lot of fun. We just recently had a get-together with people from primary school. And that was a long time ago, let me tell you. But it was fun. It was catching up with them. I think you've got to enjoy life, and I think you've got to come away from it with a bit of satisfaction that you've achieved something.
Wonderful. It's been an absolute pleasure to have you on board, Clyde. All the best. We'll be watching very eagerly.
Thank you.
And it's October, the date
17th.
Of the 17th, that's right.
Yeah.
So if you're in the city of Perth and you're voting, then hopefully that's been a good amount of information for you. But you can find more on Clyde Bevan's Facebook page in terms of his background. But you've heard it all here. Very sensible and very lovely gentleman. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much. You're very kind.
And if you've missed any of that, you can go to thecouch.com.au or obviously our Facebook page as well. Back to you, Fred.
Good luck and thank you very much, Clyde Bevan. Nisha is going to run across the set and prepare something for me to eat. Thanks to Whip Patisserie. They're back in the studio with Cedric and Nisha cooking up a storm. Over to you, Nisha.
Thank you so much, Fred. And we have Cedric joining us from Whip Patisserie again. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you again for the invitation. Really appreciate it.
We're always very excited here, fresh and local, to have you on board, especially because from a patisserie you make some very sweet, delightful things. What are we going to be making today?
So we're going to make some gluten-free tarts, gluten-free pistachio and blood orange, because the pistachio, it's all day year, all years. And the blood orange, at the moment, you got really nice, juicy blood orange.
Wonderful. So let's talk through the ingredients, because I think one of the key things that the audience may remember is that you're vegan friendly.
Yes.
Yep. And tell us a bit about how you actually, as we talk through, where you source all your ingredients from.
I got the pistachio pastry cream there. It's made with corn flour and soy milk. I use the soy milk because it's the one closest to the cow's milk.
Yes.
So it's set it properly.
Beautiful.
I got the blood orange jelly, a blood orange gel. So I made this one with raw sugar, I don't use any caster sugar, and pectin. The pectin, it's the skin of the fruit, which they dehydrate it and make a powder, which I use in my setting agents. Yep.
And this is in the place of gelatin, which is normally used. Yep, so another healthy alternative.
Exactly, that's actually the vegan alternative of gelatin.
Wonderful. Okay.
And we got some raw pistachios, just chunk pistachios.
Yes.
And we got this gluten-free tarts. So I made this tart with buckwheat flour. It's the closest for the plain flour.
Okay. So you're hosting a dinner party, which I'm sure you have many of. when do we prepare these, and how do you make these, just for the audience?
So I make in the morning because I'm doing overnight.
Yeah.
For dinner parties. If they order in the morning, they get them in the morning, otherwise the day before. And
Wonderful.
You can keep it a few days in the fridge, no problem.
Okay, so as we start to make this, and you can talk through, but tell us a bit about what Whip's been up to.
So we got a few events coming up. We got the 1st of November, we got the world event, the World Vegan Event, which is happening in a forest field.
Oh. Okay, wonderful. That's good. Well, hopefully we'll have that information up on our website that everyone can have a look at as well. So what's the first step? What are we doing
here? So I got the pistachio pastry cream. I'm going to just fill them up. So I'm going to fill them up like half.
Oh, lovely.
and...
You look so professional doing that. There's a technique to that.
Yeah, so the technique is you take it and you twist it.
Okay.
And when you push just there.
Okay, let's see if I can do something similar. Not quite as good as yours.
So the finger,
okay.
The finger here, it's actually, it's driving and the one at the back is pushing.
There you go. And tell us, where were you a pastry chef before? One of the really well-known restaurants.
So I was in Wildflower.
Wildflower. So that's why he's so good at doing right?
Yeah.
You're an elite chef.
Exactly. Okay. Exactly. I'm just going to hit up this one.
Okay, wonderful.
For 30 seconds.
And our microwave is working on set. It's real. So in terms of your Christmas coming up, what are some of the things that I guess our audience are going to have lots of events? What can we do?
Yeah, I got some Christmas log, especially French.
Cool.
Christmas log coming up. Mm-hmm. And I got a few surprises. One other surprise. It's still in working progress.
Okay.
I don't want to say too much, but it's going to be like individually boxes. With six nice items.
So very special, very special and unique.
Exactly.
So good present idea.
Yes.
What are some other events that you cater for? Because there's all sorts of things that happen throughout the year.
Well, we got the Kyla Farmers Market. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we don't have much markets and.
Yeah. So if bridal showers, weddings, any events that you can cater for as well?
Yes.
Yep. Okay, so I'm just going to mix this.
They just need 48 hours of, how can I say?
Preparation time,
yes.
Yeah.
I need two days preparation.
2 days, that's pretty good. You should know that you're having an event 2 days out.
Yes.
Wonderful. So this is nearly mixed. This smells amazing. What happens, we put this on top of the tart?
Yes, so I'm going to glaze it.
Yeah.
And I just need you to help me for the pistachios. We're going to put the pistachios straight away. Because the glaze is gonna set like
cool.
Really
so I'm your
quickly.
Pistachio assistant.
Exactly.
It's a very important role. Okay, here we go. Look at that colour, it's amazing as well. Beautiful. Blood orange.
So I just need the pistachio now. Or you can sprinkle
the whole
bit. Yeah, don't be scared.
Be very generous.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm hearing. I've promised
I like
Bridget one of these.
I like the crunches of the pistachio when you bite.
Yeah.
So
this one might be yours. Is that okay? Wonderful. So obviously visually very effective and I'm sure very tasty. Fred will try one as well. So you have to get the pistachios on very quickly. Is that the cue for it to set?
Yeah, so if it's not on quickly, the jelly is going to set, and when you're going to take the tart, you're actually moving everywhere, and you're not going to get the same, like everything, the combination of all of them together.
So timing is of the essence.
Exactly.
Here. Beautiful,
exactly.
Spoken like a true pastry chef. Okay, wonderful. So that looks good. So just in terms of the audience making these, any other tips? It's not as easy as you make
them. So this one, I do with a mold, because. Mm-hmm. And I got a circle metallic mold, but the specification is like it's perforated, so it's got some holes. That's the fact. It's got some holes. The evaporation, when you bake it, the evaporation actually go out.
Good
it doesn't
tip.
Stay.
Okay.
And it doesn't perfect, so it doesn't break.
Wonderful.
That's why it doesn't break.
Thank you for all the detail today. Obviously, very experienced and a professional. So, for those who want to know more about whipped patisserie, can you tell us a little bit about where
so
we can find out more?
You can find us at whippedpatisserie.com or on Instagram or on our Facebook.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much. Good
thank
luck
you.
For the busiest season of the year for you.
It will.
And we'll look forward to having you back hopefully very soon.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
For those of you who want more information, I'm going to start eating this. Actually, I might invite Bridget on to have some. But please visit thecouch.com.au or, of course, our Facebook page. Thank you. Back to you, Fred.
Thank you very much, Tanisha and Cedric. Always a great cooking combination. Desserts, love it, and so healthy as well for all vegans, vegetarians, and people like me that think they taste beautiful. Anyway, we're going to take a break. More of The Couch coming up right after this. Keep watching. See you soon.
Connect with The Couch online through Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube.
Welcome back to The Couch. Time for Bitchin'. We've got the three Bitchin' panellists here today. Let's thank and welcome Chris Ilsley from 6PR's Perth tonight.
Good evening. I thought we were the Three Amigos. Who changed the name?
I don't know, but we can go with Three Amigos. Jen Merrigan, number two amigo from haveagonews.com.au.
We were the Bitches.
Yeah.
You prefer the Bitches?
Yeah. Definitely.
What do you prefer?
Well, Jen? I prefer Huey, Dewey and Louie.
Okay, see, so, you know, you will do
no evil. We don't have an argument over who's Huey, Ted Bull. Yeah.
Louie. We could be the Three Musketeers.
Welcome. We've got four topics to talk about today. And you're wondering, I've got Fredo Frog. We'll talk about that right at the end. So I'll get Ted.
Yes.
We're going to talk about Trump.
I want to, yeah, I have to declare, and I have before, I'm a Republican.
Yep.
I'm not a great lover and I don't need the royal family. Yep. However, I love Meghan Markle.
Why do you love her?
Well, because I think she's such a sassy woman.
A stirrer.
And she's out there and she stirs the pot and everybody thinks the marriage isn't going to last. And it's going to. And even Trump has come out and said, I wish him luck. Well,
Trump's Meghan, right on that occasion.
Wish him luck
too.
No, how can you say that?
I want to know how you can be a Republican.
Why can't I be a Republican?
You're not a Republican.
You've got to
be a Democrat.
Didn't you swear allegiance?
Sorry. Oh, whoops.
Were right.
I believe in a republic for Australia. Oh. I'm not a royalist.
Oh, okay. Because I was going to say.
You were a Republican.
Oh, no. Oh, how embarrassing.
Didn't you swear allegiance to the Queen when you worked at the ABC?
I'd rather not talk about who I swore allegiance to, Queen or not.
So what's the gist of the story?
Well, basically, Meghan and Hazza got on telly, did this thing about, hey, everybody, you've got to vote, make sure you vote, right?
Yep.
And so those people in America somehow or other read the tea leaves and thought, oh, what she's saying is vote for Joe Biden. But she never said vote for Joe Biden.
No,
she may have intimated, I don't know. However, Trump came out and said, well, I'm not a fan of hers. What a nasty piece of business this man is.
But he didn't call her a grubby person. He didn't call her any nasty names for a change.
But he did say, what a terrible thing for the leader of the free world to say about someone's marriage, oh, it's not going to last. I mean, it's terrible if you say it about anybody's marriage.
He should know. He's had enough marriages.
Well, exactly.
You have to argue in that area.
And the one he's got at the moment is a bit dodgy too.
Once again, I agree with you.
He's not an equal opportunity kind of guy.
No. And I, what annoys me, people go on...
None of this changes the fact that Meghan Markle's a bitch.
No, she's not a bitch. Look, people say, oh, she's a strong woman.
She's
like,
stuck
if you say
up,
someone's
mate.
A strong
no,
man, that's okay.
Strong.
But a strong woman is
up.
A criticism of
but
women. She's not stuck up.
Ted,
before we allow others to talk over you, tell me, have you finished what you were going to say about Trump? I don't.
I'm not saying another thing.
You're not a Trump lover, can we say
no,
that?
No, no, no. So I don't dislike Trump because I think I have no say or sway in the American election, so I won't get involved in that because it doesn't matter.
But you think he shouldn't have attacked Megan?
No, I think it's sort of what it does. It demeans his position as president.
But it's nothing
of the
new
USA.
For him. He doesn't care who.
He doesn't
president.
Care. He's not a politician. That's why.
A terrible
in fact,
person.
I was looking at this the other day. I think he is the only senior politician like to get elected president or leader of a country who got there with no prior political experience.
Correct.
He may have had reality television.
Look, I think we're unanimous.
That's not political
experience.
It is.
Look,
television
isn't political.
We all expect
him
not to win.
Not for him.
None of us want to see him as another 4-year president there. He's done some terrible things.
Definitely not.
He's a strong man, and I give him that. He's a great businessman, but he's not a...
But is he a great businessman?
Oh, look, he's
been broke. No, I don't think he is. He's been broke a couple of times, and don't forget he inherited his money from his
being
father.
Being broke is a lot different
in America than it is in Australia.
Really?
Yes.
Right. Yeah, think
well,
called Chapter
way,
11.
The way that they do bankruptcy.
Oh. Chapter 11, you can trade
Donald
your way
Trump,
out.
He did trade his way out.
Correct.
So when he's gone, still, when he's
well,
done
when he's,
the Chapter 11 bankruptcy,
ooh.
He's
can
he's
I do
paid,
on the side?
Yep.
This business that they're talking about post-COVID, bringing in an act or a change to the Bankruptcy Act in Australia
in
that
Australia.
Will operate similar to the US Chapter 11. Mm. You can continue trading and trade your way out. Basically, in Australia, what you do is the crows go in with the latest bank kill and they sell up the assets and the secured creditors get their bit and everybody else fights
Look,
over the chips.
We certainly don't want to follow
in,
the Americans.
Under Chapter 11, you can trade your way out of a situation.
Gee, I'm
exactly.
really looking forward
Look,
to it. Will this work in Monopoly?
Do you want to wrap your discussion about Trump?
Can't you win in Monopoly?
No.
Ted, do you want to wrap it up so we can move on to...
Yes.
Move on to Jim.
I've
Anything you want
up.
To say as a final
Well,
word?
All I can say is that Megan, she's hot, she swings, she's great, my kind of woman.
And do you want to repeat what you said about her?
I think she's a bitch and she's stuck up.
Well, at least we have opposing views. Jen Merrigan, Rose Between Two Thorns.
Yeah,
I have
you.
To say, I don't particularly like or not like her. I think she's no Diana. And I think Diana was such a beautiful person.
Oh, but
person,
Diana but was manipulated and
I get
oh.
it. I get
and
it.
A manipulator. But Harry's happy.
Yep. Well, yeah, let's move on, because I think most people
Harry
out there saying
happy.
He doesn't want to
who's
family.
Had strategic parts of his anatomy metaphorically cut off. He's never happy.
Jen, what's your story, quickly?
Oh, this is big news.
Now, yeah,
come on.
Stop everything. This is the most important thing you'll hear all night.
This is the big change to the Aussie favourite, Fredo Frog. 90 years. I just can't believe that
What's
Fredo
happening?
Frogs have been going for 90 years.
But even
for
Fredo, he's changed anyway. Once before.
Can well, I give you a chocolate each?
Yes.
There you go. Ted,
I'll pass
them
on.
We need to have a test.
There you go.
Yes, thank you.
Well, the thing is, the actual, the original Fredo Frog looked like a real frog.
Yes.
This is going to sound really good on TV.
So what's the change? Why have they made this?
Okay. So what they're doing, the new Fredo is going to be wrapped in recyclable foil packaging. With a new design intended to bring colourful fun. This is a great ad for Cadbury's, isn't it?
Mm.
Without the, and then they're going to do the similar thing to what Yowie and Kinder Surprise
has done. Oh, what happened with
them?
And they're going to make it bigger.
Yeah.
And they're going to put little lollies in there.
Lollies. And what will the lollies look like, Jen?
And the lollies are going to look like
little animals.
This.
So
now they call them candies.
Oh, there you go. There's a picture on screen right now.
That's too American for us.
There,
they're
we've
lollies.
Got it on there. See,
the vegans are going to go feral.
I find that sick. I really do. Opening up Fredo Frog and inside.
Can you imagine some young kid eating that?
Exactly. Do you know what? Can I ask you, or do you think at the moment we've got this obsession of changing everything old to something new? Yeah. I mean, why did we have to change Fredo Frog? What's wrong with the ones that we eat?
We don't, but I think what they're trying to do is get in on that market, like the Kinder Surprise thing, and not do it with plastic.
But hang on, this has been around longer. Fredo or Kinder Surprise?
No, Fredo Frog's been around.
Fredo Frog's been around for 90 years.
Yep. I just counted the number of creatures.
I don't know about Kinder Surprise.
So I just counted the number of creatures, and it's a menagerie of 9.
No, fantastic. Look, we need to move on so Chris can have a say. But Fredo Frog, check them out.
He's already
check
had
them
one.
Out. Check, the, check it out in the supermarket. These are the old ones. And if it's another little gimmick, I would have to say they're probably trying to sell all the old stock. But Chris, what's your story?
They're all going to... Oh, my story. Mutant Ushies.
Now, these
from
are those
Woolworths.
Things you get from Woolworths when you spend so much money.
$30. $30. But there are some of them that...
But you only get one.
Yeah.
No.
I think you get about two or three.
One.
You only get one.
I can assure you, you got more than one.
Do you know what? I got 6 the other day and I spent about $140. So it must be
That's
more than...
That's because they liked you.
Okay. Mm.
They thought, here's a man who collects ooshies.
And I thought you could eat them because they said to me, are you collecting? I thought, they look like lollies, you know, those soft. And I took one and I said, took them home and I opened it. And I said, can you eat these? And someone said, no, you don't eat the damn thing. You put them on top of your pencil. I thought, oh, here, you can have them. I gave them away. But look, some of them are very valuable.
Yes, and these mutant ones were actually out of the production run and they had faults in them. You know, like Woody without an arm or something like that.
Really? Are they the valuable ones?
Two with the wrong colour or the body of one and the head of another. But these have now got huge online value.
Really?
Yes.
Isn't there a gold one as well that's worth a lot of money?
That kind of looks like it's suffered.
Girls of our work have been
actually,
trading.
The gold one looks like
girls
it's been...
Girls at your work? How old are the girls?
They're trading them
they're
for the grandchildren.
They're not girls, they're women.
Yeah, people have got them on eBay. They're all making
Son
money.
Of it, we
the promotion's
that,
ended, by the way.
When was it? The 1990s, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Yeah.
I'm trying to work out, you know, now we could have Woolworths Mutant Ninja Ushies. It doesn't quite fly the
Coles had the miniature, you know, washing powder.
Did you
and
eat
all
them too?
No, I didn't. Tell they were plastic.
One
very
way
light.
To give yourself a good clean out.
Woolworths have apparently said that the competition's over. They're not running them anymore. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a lot of people who have profiteered out of these things.
Oh, they're always
as there always is, which is really sad.
But can I just make an observation?
Go for
Mr.
It,
Kildroy here. Why do we get our knickers in a twist about people selling them? Because for any transaction, you have to have a willing buyer.
Correct.
Now, listen, if you've got 10 grand to spend on ushies, the Ilsley Benevolent Fund is taking any and all donations.
Exactly.
I mean, really?
And do you give an ushie?
No, I don't give him anything.
And you're not a pushy-ushy.
I'm not a pushy-ushy.
You're more of a mushy-ushy.
I'll just take the money.
Maybe you can give them a Freddo frog.
They have Japanese grand. Ones too. They're can called sushi-ushies.
if you've got these ushies out there, put them on eBay, sell them because you can't eat them. So there's no point having it.
Fred's
can
trying.
I just ask a quick question, last question for you without notice. People that are, the jobs that are going in the country in regards to picking fruit.
Yep.
Yes.
Can I ask you individually, before we do a collective discussion, but do you think young people that are on the dole or JobKeeper that are not working at the moment, I'm not having a go at any individuals, do you think they should be made to go and take these jobs instead of bringing people from overseas to fill these vacancies?
Well, for a start, I think they should want to, because what a great experience in life. Mm-hmm. I don't think it should be a case of you're forced to do it, because then it becomes a bit sort of, Nazi-like, doesn't it? You know,
I don't think you force people, but they should want to go out and do a job.
Well, I think
but
if you're willing
to take the public's largesse in the form of taxpayer
funds. Absolutely.
Sorry, Ted, I don't buy the Nazi comparison. Actually have a responsibility, and you don't sit on your home on your bum at home on JobKeeper or JobSeeker. Yeah. You get them all confused.
They're both the same.
Playing at the end of the day. I'm sorry.
We need a land army, Fred.
I guess it doesn't matter if it's JobKeeper or JobSeeker. Mm. If you're on JobKeeper, you've still got a job maybe to go back to, but you're still not working, and you're getting paid by the taxpayer the $3,000
to basically sit on your bum.
Two and a half.
Which is fine if you don't have a job and there aren't any jobs.
But you should be made to take on jobs that are available.
The only exception, look, for young people, don't forget this is physically demanding work, so guys like you and I probably wouldn't do so well doing it. But if you have no attachments. If you could, for example, go and stay at a country pub and work picking fruit, there's no reason why you can't do it. If, for example, you're on JobKeeper and you've got a family and you've got a home, that's maybe a different story.
Well, JobKeeper, most people who are using that in WA, if they're still using it, is because of their turnover. So they're probably still at work. They actually are going to work.
There's a lot of stories out there in Victoria.
I think it's completely different.
But it isn't just the fruit picking. I mean, as you know, I've just been up to Broome, and you're heading up there.
Yes.
Their big problem is lack of staff. Mm. I mean, you're getting hotels who are saying, look, we'll charge you less and we won't service your room every day.
And the government is giving you a huge bonus to go up there as well. And there's accommodation allowances and all sorts
that's
of
things. That's what I'm thinking.
That's why I believe
I've changed my mind.
We need a land army.
I've changed my mind.
I tend to agree.
Everybody up and up there immediately.
Ted will take them like the Pied Piper, will take them up to the picking fruit.
Up, two, three, four, pick those fruits.
I think most of us, if I was 18 to 20 and on the dole and bored, and I think if the government made it a little bit of an incentive where pay for the accommodation, send them up there for a month at a time.
They are doing that, but
I don't think they're promoting
it
well enough.
It would be an adventure. I mean, where's the adventure in our youth today?
Yeah, look, I tend to think if there's a lot of money being spent on all people that aren't employed, and go to the youth and then go to people who can physically do that work.
Yeah.
And I do agree with Chris. If you've got five children and a wife and husband,
it's a little bit
a little bit different.
I'll
break up a
that,
family.
That's different, but
I wouldn't
young
force
to be right single people. Yeah.
Well, that's why a land army kind of thing. In the Second World War, there wasn't enough people to pick the fruit and vegetables back then, and they organised the Women's Land Army.
Correct.
And they went all around the country and picked everything as the season was happening.
And they worked in factories too, don't forget, they made all the munitions and everything.
Yeah. And then when the war ended, they couldn't get any work.
Yeah, exactly. And then they were back to being housewives.
Yes.
Look,
strong women.
Great feedback. Thank you very much for having your say on JobKeeper and the fruit picking. Yeah. I think a lot of people out there are saying, you know, are we wrong in saying, you know, people on the dole, people on JobKeeper should be doing something for that money while they can, and I think most of us
agree. Don't forget, they're getting more money for JobKeeper than they were getting for the dole.
Exactly. Mm. Let's thank our panel. Of course, Ted Bull, as always, you're always welcome.
Thank you.
TV, radio personality, never-ending personality. Thank you very much for coming back from
Broome. Thanks for having me.
Jen Merrigan, Have A Go News, always a great read. haveagonews.com.au, always a new edition. You can check it out online.
Yes.
And Chris Ilsley with Perth's only local and live entertainment, news, review, music, everything. If it's happening in Perth, you'll catch it on Perth Tonight, 8 to midnight every night of the week.
You need to be my agent.
Well, is it true you're doing it naked these days,
Thank
Chris?
You very much for being
there
on the show.
There is no way I would do anything naked. Nobody, no matter who they are, has done anything sufficiently bad as to warrant seeing me
and
naked.
And on that note, I think we need to end the show.
Oh, you probably
picture Chris naked and then picture me
naked. Oh,
no,
don't do that. You will never unsee it.
Thank you very much to Isabel. She's centre stage. She's going to perform for us now. And she's telling Chris, don't start now. So here she is. Have a wonderful week. Keep smiling and bye for now. And we'll catch you next week on the couch. Bye-bye.
You don't want to see me. Did a fool 180 crazy, thinking about the way I was. Did the heartbreak change me? Maybe, but look at where I ended up. I'm all good already, so moved on. It's scary. Come out.